Have you ever stopped to question time itself? What if I told you that time, as you know it, might not actually exist? That the ticking clock, the steady march of minutes, the difference between past, present, and future is all just an illusion? It sounds impossible, right? But hold on, because by the end of this video, you'll see why some of the greatest minds in history, philosophers and scientists alike, have argued that time isn't real. And once you understand this, it might just change how you live your life forever. Picture this. It's Monday morning. Your alarm buzzes at 7 a.m., dragging you out of a deep sleep. You rush to the kitchen, coffee in hand, eyeing the clock as the minutes tick down to your first meeting. Later, stuck in traffic, you glance at your watch again, every second feeling like an eternity. Your entire day revolves around time, worrying about having enough of it, trying to save it and racing against it. But what if you've been thinking about time all wrong? Over 100 years ago, French philosopher Henri Bergson proposed a radical idea. Time isn't a measurable force. It's not a straight line moving from past to future. Instead, it's something deeply tied to how we experience life. He called this duration, and his groundbreaking ideas shook the world. Today, we're diving into Bergson's revolutionary view of time and how it can free you from the stress of schedules, deadlines, and the never-ending pressure to make every second count. For most of us, time feels like an external reality, something out there that controls our lives. We use clocks to measure it, calendars to plan it, and schedules to organize it. But according to Bergson, this is all a convenient fiction. What we think of as time is actually just a tool we invented. Think about it. When you watch the hands of a clock move, are you really seeing time, or are you just observing motion in space? Clocks don't measure time. They measure changes in physical systems. Whether it's the swing of a pendulum, the ticking of gears, or the oscillation of atoms, what you're seeing isn't time itself. It's just movement. Bergson argued that this measured version of time, what we call clock time, is useful, yes, but it's also an illusion. We've built our lives around it, carving our days into hours, minutes, and seconds. But that doesn't mean it's real. Measured time is like a map. It helps us navigate the world, but it's not the world itself. Just as a map reduces the complexity of a landscape into simple lines and shapes, clock time reduces the richness of lived experience into a sequence of units. But real time, the time we actually live, can't be divided into pieces. If measured time is an illusion, then what's the reality? Bergson believed that the true nature of time lies in duration, a continuous flow of experience that can't be broken down into parts. To understand this, think about how time feels when you're completely absorbed in something you love. Reading a gripping novel, watching a thrilling movie, or having a deep conversation with a friend. Hours can pass, but it feels like only minutes. Conversely, when you're stuck in a boring meeting or waiting in line at the DMV, every second drags on endlessly. This isn't just a quirk of perception, it's the essence of duration. Unlike measured time, which is rigid and linear, duration is flexible and fluid. It stretches and contracts based on how you're experiencing life. In fact, Bergson argued that duration is the only real form of time. It's not something external, like a clock ticking on a wall. It's internal, rooted in your consciousness. Duration is the feeling of time flowing through you, blending moments together in a seamless stream. Here's where it gets even more mind-blowing. If duration is real, then the past and future don't actually exist. The only thing that's real is the present moment. Think about it. When you remember a past event, say a childhood birthday, where is that memory happening? It's not back there in some distant past. It's happening now, in your mind. Similarly, when you imagine the future, dreaming about your next vacation or worrying about a big project, you're doing it in the present. For Bergson, the past and future are mental constructs. They exist only as extensions of the now. The past lives on in your memory, shaping how you perceive the present. The future exists as a potential, emerging from the choices you make in the moment. This challenges everything we think we know about time. Instead of seeing it as a line stretching from past to future, Bergson saw it as a continuous flow, where the present contains the seeds of everything, past, present, and future all woven together in a single eternal now. This revolutionary view of time wasn't just controversial. It led to one of the most famous intellectual battles of the 20th century, Henri Bergson versus Albert Einstein. Einstein's theory of relativity turned our understanding of time on its head. He showed that time isn't absolute, it's relative, depending on factors like speed and gravity. Time, in Einstein's view, is a dimension, like space, something that can be measured, stretched, and warped. But Bergson wasn't convinced. He argued that Einstein's scientific time missed the point. Sure, you can measure time mathematically, but that doesn't capture how we actually experience it. For Bergson, time wasn't a dimension. It was a lived reality, tied to our emotions, memories, and consciousness. Their debate, which took place in 1922, was a clash between two worldviews: the objective, measurable time of physics versus the subjective, experiential time of philosophy. Einstein dismissed Bergson's ideas as irrelevant to science. Bergson, in turn, argued that Einstein's equations described only one narrow aspect of time, leaving out the richness of human experience. At this point, you might be thinking, okay, this is all fascinating, but why does it matter to me? Here's why. Bergson's ideas can completely transform the way you live your life. Most of us feel like time is constantly slipping away. We stress about the future, regret the past, and feel trapped by the relentless ticking of the clock. But if Bergson was right, then this anxiety is based on a misunderstanding. Measured time, the kind we track on clocks and calendars, is just a tool. It's not real. The only real time is duration, the flow of experience. And that means you're never truly running out of time, because time isn't something you can have or lose. It's something you live. Imagine freeing yourself from the pressure of the clock. Instead of racing against time, you could immerse yourself in the present, savoring each moment for what it is. Understanding Bergson's concept of duration isn't just an intellectual exercise, it's a transformative way of living. In a world dominated by schedules, deadlines, and ticking clocks, we often feel trapped by the passage of time. We worry about the future, regret the past, and feel the pressure of time slipping away. But what if we could free ourselves from this mental prison? Bergson believed that recognizing the illusion of measured time allows us to embrace the richness of the present moment. When we focus on duration, the flow of experience, we stop seeing time as a scarce resource to be managed. Instead, we begin to live fully in the now. Imagine you're at a concert, lost in the music. In that moment, you're not thinking about the time on your watch or the tasks waiting for you tomorrow. You're immersed in the flow of duration, where measured time fades away. These are the moments when we feel most alive, when we're not counting the minutes, but simply being. Bergson's philosophy encourages us to cultivate these experiences, to step out of the framework of measured time and into the flow of life. It's not about ignoring the practicalities of schedules and deadlines, but about shifting our perspective. By living in duration, we can reduce stress, find greater joy, and experience a deeper connection to the present. The debate between Bergson and Einstein wasn't just a clash of ideas, it was a clash of worlds. Einstein represented the scientific view of time, objective, measurable, and governed by physical laws. His theory of relativity showed that time is not a universal constant, but something that can stretch and warp depending on speed and gravity. This was a revolutionary insight, reshaping our understanding of the universe. Bergson, on the other hand, was concerned with time as it's experienced by human beings. For him, Einstein's time was an abstraction, useful for physics, but disconnected from the reality of lived experience. Bergson argued that time cannot be fully captured by equations or clocks because it's not something external. It's something internal, tied to our consciousness. Their debate highlights a fundamental tension between science and philosophy: the objective versus the subjective. the measurable versus the experiential. While Einstein's view of time has become the foundation of modern physics, Bergson's ideas continue to resonate with those who seek to understand the deeper, more personal dimensions of reality. In many ways, this debate is still alive today. Science provides incredible insights into the mechanics of time, but it often overlooks the human experience. Bergson reminds us that time isn't just something we study, it's something we live. Bergson's ideas aren't just theoretical. They have profound implications for how we navigate our lives. If time is an illusion, what does that mean for how we work, plan, and live? First, let go of the clock. In our modern world, we're constantly racing against the clock, trying to squeeze as much as possible into every hour. But this mindset creates stress and anxiety, making us feel like there's never enough time. Bergson's philosophy invites us to step back and reconsider. Instead of obsessing over measured time, we can focus on the quality of our experiences. By living in duration, we can find greater peace and satisfaction. Second, embrace the present. The present moment is the only reality we ever truly experience. By shifting our attention away from the past and future, both of which exist only as mental constructs, we can fully engage with the now. This doesn't mean ignoring responsibilities or abandoning plans. It means recognizing that life happens in the present, and the more we connect with it, the richer our experiences become. Third, rethink memory and regret. If the past is always present within us, then regret becomes less about something we can't change and more about how we interpret and integrate our experiences. Memory isn't fixed, it's fluid, allowing us to reshape our understanding of the past in ways that serve us better. Finally, reclaim time as a personal experience. Instead of letting society dictate how we should experience time, we can reclaim it as something deeply personal. Whether it's spending an afternoon immersed in a hobby, losing yourself in a great book, or simply savoring a moment of stillness, these experiences remind us of the true nature of time. Why does Bergson's philosophy matter now, more than a century after he first introduced it? Because our relationship with time has only grown more complicated. In the digital age, where every second is tracked, measured, and monetized, we've become more aware than ever of time slipping through our fingers. We live by the clock, constantly checking the time on our phones, our watches, and our screens. But what if we could break free from this obsession? What if we could stop seeing time as something external, something to be managed, and start experiencing it as something internal, something to be lived? Bergson's philosophy offers a way to do just that. It challenges us to rethink our assumptions, to question the frameworks we've built around time, and to reconnect with the flow of duration, the continuous, ever-present stream of life. By understanding time as an illusion, we can begin to see the world and ourselves in a new light. We can let go of the pressure to make the most of every second and instead focus on living fully in the moment. In a world that's constantly rushing forward, Bergson's ideas remind us of the beauty of simply being. So, what will you do with this new understanding of time? Will you keep chasing the clock, or will you step into the flow of duration and live in the richness of the now?